Okay, so we're going to have a look at cutting fluids. We've seen these in a lot of videos already. You know, pretty much any of the CNC machining videos, you're going to see cutting fluid. So we'll talk a little bit about what that stuff is and how to take care of it, what to watch out for. All right, so the reason that we use this stuff primarily is to cool the workpiece and keep the tool cooled down, and mostly about keeping the tool cooled down. And it's also to provide lubrication. So when you're machining, you have this metal on metal contact, and as you know, that builds up friction, and friction generates heat and wears down tools, things like that. So we want to keep the tool cooled down, and we want to lubricate it. Also, these cutting fluids can help remove chips. In fact, in some cases, you'll actually force the cutting fluid down through the spindle and through the tool, and actually just pump chips out. Like when you're drilling a hole, you can have through the spindle coolant that will pump the chips completely out of the hole as you drill them. Also, the coolant should provide some corrosion protection. So, you know, having water around steel parts, just a recipe for rust. You should know, I've tried to make the point in the semester, but most of these metal parts in the shop, the vices and things like that, most of those things are not made out of stainless steel. They're usually made out of some kind of tool steel or alloy steel, but typically not stainless. And so these things will rust. And if you had a water-based coolant in there that didn't have any kind of corrosion protection in it, then those parts would be prone to rust. All right, so let's look at sort of the two components. So you can have oil and or water used as a lubricant, and each one does its own sort of job. So water, as you can see here, is a better media to remove heat. So heat can move into the water and be carried away by the water easier than it can by the oil. Okay, so so if you need to cool things down, water is the best choice. But as you also know, lubrication is done better with oil. This is why your car has two different systems. You've got the oil circulating inside the engine where there's a lot of friction, and you're pumping water in through that engine block to remove the heat. So two separate systems, each one has sort of its own strong points. So this is sort of an aside, but that doesn't mean it's not important. So you want, as part of your coolant, you want the coolant to wet the part that the part and the tool. You want this kind of reaction. So this idea of wetting has actually been important several times in my career. I had no idea that something as mundane as whether or not something can get wet or not would have much of an effect. But it has come up many times in my career, and it's been a much more important thing than I ever realized. Okay, so the way that a liquid can interface with a solid like this is it's a function of the surface tension that's generated between these two, okay? And the reaction can either be a hydrophobic reaction where the water beads up. So, you may have waxed a car, and then when it rains on the car after you've freshly waxed it, you'll see a hydrophobic reaction, interaction. You'll see the water bead up like this. The opposite of this, where you have good wetting, is when there is a hydrophilic reaction or action between the water or the liquid, whatever it is, and the surface. Okay, so this depends on the action of both things. It's not just about the liquid, it's not just about the solid. What you want is a good interface like this. The way that you measure how wettable a surface is with a particular liquid is by measuring what's called the contact angle. So this is a very high, a large contact angle, and so we see that there's actually a sort of a repelling force between the liquid and the solid. This is a hydrophobic reaction with a very large contact angle. You may have a small contact angle like this, and it's kind of important. If you lose your bearings on this, you might get the contact angle the wrong way. So typically, you know, the way that it's measured is in the inside of the droplet. So small contact angle, hydrophilic; large contact angle, hydrophobic. So you may have seen videos about this. You know, this is an advertisement for a material that will produce a hydrophobic reaction. But in terms of a cutting fluid, which one do you think you would want? Would you want hydrophobic or hydrophilic? And the answer is, well, let's go back a screen. Look at this. Which one do you think is going to do a better job of cooling this part down? It's going to be the one with the hydrophilic reaction. And so sometimes cutting fluids will have in them wetting agents. You know, kind of the way that soap works. Soap will act as a wetting agent. All right, so we'll look at some of the types of cutting oils. You can use straight mineral oils. So mineral oils are those that are petroleum based. They come out of the ground. They've been they've been refined to a certain degree, and they can be used without any water at oil or oil. So you'll use these straight oils or neat oils when you have a lot of friction and not very high speeds, when you're not generating an awful lot of heat. So that's the main idea behind mineral oils or straight oils. You can also have oils that have extreme pressure lubricants in them. All right, these are sometimes called active cutting oils. So what happens with these is you have these kind of reactive chemicals in there, like sulfur, chlorine, and phosphorus. And what happens is, under the extreme pressure, these will cause reactions that minimize the friction between the parts. And so there's actually a chemical reaction that happens between the surface of the material and these sulfur compounds, chlorine compounds, to add some additional friction protection. All right, now a nice big class of cutting oils that are very common. This is what we use down in the lab in ET112. Are the emulsified oils or soluble oils. So in these, you have, well, let me back up. So if you've ever, you've probably done this as a science experiment, maybe in elementary school, where you take oil and water and you combine them together and you see very quickly that they don't mix. Okay, so like salad dressing, you know, it's got oil and water in it. When you buy salad dressing from the store, you can shake it up and it stays mixed up. And the reason is they put emulsifying agents in there. What those emulsifying agents do is they kind of surround the droplets of oil, sort of put a little jacket on them, and it gives them a sort of a different way to interface with the water. So what the emulsifiers do is allow the oil to be mixed with water. So based on our discussion earlier, that sounds like a really great thing. And it is, because that allows the oil to be present, to be a lubricant, and it allows the water to be present as a heat-reducing medium. All right, so then you may also hear about types of cutting oils that are synthetic or chemical, as the term is sometimes used. So what these are, it says it doesn't contain petroleum oil. And what's generally how this works is you actually start with petroleum oil. And in a typical, the way that you process petroleum products, you start with crude oil and you pump it into this thing called a fractional distillation column. You heat up the oil and it vaporizes. And then at various levels in this fractional distillation column, the evaporated petroleum products or vaporized petroleum products will condense at different levels. So down at the bottom of this big tower, and that's what it is, it's just a giant tower, it's a big tank that has levels in it. The lowest levels, the heaviest hydrocarbons, will condense on the inside of this thing, and they'll be collected down at the bottom. And these will be, down at the very bottom, you have things like asphalt, and then you start moving up, you have really heavy oils, and you wind up in diesel fuel and jet fuel and things like that. Lower down, higher up, you get things like gasoline, and then you get to mineral spirits, and up higher, you get some stuff that becomes commercial feedstock. But this is petroleum oil that's been separated out into its different sort of hydrocarbon classes by their weight and their hydrocarbon, you know, the size of the molecules, essentially. So you're starting with crude oil, and that's a fairly, you know, it's a natural product. It has all kinds of chemicals mixed in it, and you can use it like that. That's how we use gasoline. You just filter, you know, you just kind of, it's like a big giant still, and you distill out the gasoline or whatever the lubricant is. So those are non-synthetics. And then what you can do is take those different hydrocarbons and take them completely apart until they become a very small, highly purified collection of highly purified collection of chemicals that that then get put back together. So they've been synthesized. So you take the crude oil, take it completely apart, and then reassemble the individual pieces out of that crude oil into synthetic fluids. And of course, sometimes these are mixed. You have some mineral oil, some unrefined. Well, not, it's not unrefined. It is refined, but it's not synthetic. It hasn't been taken apart and put back together. So you can have this mix of those two. So some of the advantages: you've got rapid heat dissipation. You have very clean materials, very clean fluids. You have these light residual films that are easy to remove. They're easily mixed. So just kind of, you know, high performance in general. You can tune them to get just the sort of types of reactions and behaviors that you'd like. And there are some disadvantages that you can see there. Lack of lubricity, high detergency. They kind of irritate hands sometimes. They tend to foam, and sometimes you get disposal problems. You may see gaseous fluids used. So just a reminder that this term fluids, those can be either gases or liquids. They just don't, they're fluid because they don't have a defined shape to them. So you can use compressed air, just as compressed air as a cutting fluid. You'll see that sometimes with certain plastics and things like that. Kind of loud, but it doesn't make any kind of a mess, okay? You may see sometimes these vortex tubes used. This is kind of a rare thing. I do mention them here because they're kind of a neat invention. If you're not familiar with these, you should look them up. With no moving parts, just by using compressed air, you can get really cold air out of one end and hot air out of the other end. Well, it's just worth looking into if you're not sure about that. Very rarely you might see things like argon, helium, nitrogen used. That's going to be expensive, and it's only going to be in very very specialized applications. But they're just mentioned here just out of, you know, trying to be complete. All right, other fluids, you may have, you may see pastes and gels used. These are used when heat's not an issue, okay? So this is strictly going to be low-speed cutting, typically sort of manual cutting, maybe tapping and drilling. And these are used, products like this, you're going to use, you know, when you can't get cutting fluids there another way, or when you're fighting against gravity. These will tend to stay put. You can put them at the place where you're going to be cutting or tapping, and use them locally. All right, so some of the factors that are going to determine the cutting fluid that you use, and this is just a partial list. This is kind of simplified out of the Tool and Manufacturing Engineer's Handbook. They have a whole spreadsheet, well, not just sort of a worksheet to break down and allow you to analyze different cutting fluids and how they're going to perform economically. So the machining time per part will go into this, how acceptable the surface finish is, how important the surface finish is, the downtime due to changes, tool changes, and maintenance. So if you may be able to reduce the downtime, you may be able to reduce tool changes by moving to a more expensive cutting fluid. The fluid consumption per part is an issue. Do you have a lot of carry out? Is there a lot of evaporation because of the process that you're using? The batch life, how long the stuff is going to last once it's been mixed up. Also, the shelf life, and then the disposal and recycling costs, getting rid of it, looking at the total cost of ownership of this stuff, the entire, storing the concentrate and getting rid of the used cutting fluid, or how much it, sometimes this stuff is recycled on site. There are cutting fluid manufacturers that will make whole reconditioning systems that can recondition the fluid, and it can be filtered and put back into use. Probably the most important part of this is the compatibility for the cutting fluid to do the job. You know, obviously this is kind of the first thing between the workpiece and the tool. All right, so this next section is about getting the cutting fluid where it belongs. There are different methods of doing this, and we'll look at those real quickly. There's flood application, which again, you've seen a lot of this. Any of the videos that you watch about CNC machining, like I say, you're going to see some kind of cutting fluid application. Flood application, where you just pump it to the side of the cut, is probably the most common. In certain situations, like this little router setup, you may not be able to accommodate a big flood of coolant. Okay, so here they're just doing some machining with this router, and they have mist coolant. So you have just a finer mist of coolant, and with that mist of coolant, it kind of blows past, with compressed air and the convection from that, as well as the evaporation. Will help cool the tool down. If you hear strange noises in the background, that's Tom Banning making himself at home. All right, then there is high pressure through the spindle coolant, and this is where the coolant is pumped through the actual spindle of the machine and out through a hollow tool. So these tools have coolant passageways cut into them, and the pressure the coolant is pumped actually through the tool and delivered at the point of the cut. All right, let's see. So here's the same idea. This is through the tool coolant for a lathe. Very common to have drills, especially if you're drilling deep holes, to have coolant go actually through the spindle and through the tool. This is kind of the highest performance delivery method. Allows you to really increase the production with, especially with things like drilling and milling. This is a little look. This is the Haas. It's not one of the tip of the days. This was kind of predates that, but this is a look at high spindle through the high pressure through the spindle coolant. It's a pretty good look at it, and they describe the different capabilities of the Haas machines to add this option. Okay, so just a great thing with drilling. It just does dramatic increases in productivity, dramatic reductions in cycle time in drilling operations. All right, so this cutting fluid, kind of as we mentioned, it starts to get dirty, it starts to get stuff dissolved in it, and it starts to get what's called tramp oil on the surface. So if you were in 1711 and you cut the hammer, I may have shown you the tramp oil that tends to accumulate in the cold saw. So these are oils that come from the machine lubrication and from lubrication on the parts themselves that gets washed off and gets flushed down into the coolant tank. Well, this tramp oil is, if you have a system that has a filtration unit in there, it tends to sort of foul the filter unit and reduces the filtration capacity of the filter unit. Okay, and so one of the things that's done is the tramp oils get skimmed off, and these are things that you can buy. You can go out to MSC and buy tramp oil filtration or tramp oil skimmers that will skim the tramp oil off of the coolant and allow you to have the coolant sort of cleaned of that tramp oil. Then there are things you can get to further condition that coolant to get rid of, to filter it out. There are magnetic separators and centrifuges and things like that. But really, it's really common to have, number one, filters and tramp oil skimmers on a filtration unit inside of a machine or as ancillary equipment to a machine. All right, so coolant does get consumed. You do recycle coolant, obviously. You pump it, and then it makes its way down into a sump tank, and then it gets repumped out and recirculated. But it doesn't last forever. One thing that happens to it is it goes away. All right, so two things that can make it go away is that it can evaporate, and this is the water evaporating out, and through evaporation, the coolant will become more concentrated. And you can have evaporation. Evaporation can happen from the tank itself, and it can also happen as part of the cutting process. So a lot of it's there to reduce the heat. So as it's doing that job of reducing the heat, it takes the heat into itself. That heats it up. That makes it evaporate more quickly. Also, some operations may atomize the cutting fluid. It will, send it into the air and atomize it, and that makes evaporation happen really rapidly. So evaporation will make the coolant go away. The other thing that happens to coolant is it gets carried out. This is a phenomenon called carryout, as you might imagine, and it can carry out with the parts themselves. It can also get carried out with chips. So what happens in general with carryout is it can tend to make the coolant less concentrated. All right, so there are maintenance concerns. Maintenance is a big part of using coolant, all right? So if you're going to have coolant in your machines, there are going to be maintenance considerations. It'd be nice if you could just put the stuff in there and forget about it. Unfortunately, you can't. In fact, the more care that you put into sort of maintaining the coolant, the better luck you're going to have with it, and really the less of a hassle it's going to be overall. Obviously, the storage issues. Sometimes in some cities, water quality is an issue, in some cities more than others. Rancidity control, being able to control the bacteria and fungi that tend to grow in the coolant. One thing that happens with tramp oil, like we were talking about before, is you wind up with this anaerobic growth, which is the bacteria that's going to grow outside of the presence of oxygen, and they tend to be even nastier than the aerobic bacteria that grow in the presence of oxygen. So it's not like you can just add oxygen and solve the problem or get rid of oxygen and solve the problem. You're going to get one or the other. What was the other? Okay. All right, so some of the physical tests. There are tests for viscosity and flash point and stability, emulsion stability, these other physical properties of the mixture itself. But what's generally done is a concentration test. So you test the concentration of the coolant that's in the tank. So the tool that's used for this most often is a refractometer. All right, so this tool is going to measure essentially the speed of light, the index of refraction, of the liquid, and by doing that, you can determine the concentration of the fluid. Now, there are correction factors based on the type of fluid that you're actually measuring, but you can get that from the manufacturer, and you do a little calibration, and essentially this is going to tell you the concentration of the mixture, the cutting fluid and water mixed together. Just for the purposes of being an educated person, make sure that you understand the definition of viscosity. That's sort of the measure of the internal friction inside of a liquid as it flows. So something with high viscosity is going to flow more slowly than something with a low viscosity. And then also the flash point. So the flash point is the temperature at which the vapors above a liquid become ignitable. You may have heard that diesel fuel is safer than gasoline. because it has a lower flash point, and that is that it has to get hotter before flammable vapors form above the out of that liquid. You might also take pH test. These are going to give you ideas about rancidity and also about corrosion problems. So you should know that really any of these industrial chemicals that you're around, if you're around them occupationally, you want to really try to minimize your exposure to them. So they may not be super hazardous in casual contact, but when you have this stuff on your hands every day, a lot of these chemicals can cause this condition of occupational dermatitis. Okay, so the CDC has a real nice topic on that with all kinds of lovely pictures. The thing is, you want to, number one, be informed about the cutting fluid that you are using or that the workers are using. Make sure that people that are being exposed to this stuff have access to and are familiar with and can read the SDS. Okay, so make sure that any PPE requirements spelled out in the SDS are available to the workforce that are in contact with this stuff, and also minimize the contact with people using it. There are different types of ways that these cutting fluids can be toxic. You can get them in your mouth. They can cause oral toxicity. You can get inhalation toxicity just by walking through a facility if you're atomizing a bunch of coolant and you don't have collection units to minimize that that atomized coolant that's in the air. Dermal or skin toxicity, and you can get irritation of the skin and eyes are also a risk. There's a really good Haas video series on coolant and how to care for coolant and calculating volumes of, I think we're going to talk about the rest of this stuff, but the Haas video series on coolant is really, really good. There's also you may not think it's great from the title, but this is another Haas video. Coolant the Movie is kind of an overview of coolants overall. Really good watching, about 30 minutes of that. This is probably not the most exciting stuff out there, but if you're working in a facility or if you have a facility that's using coolant, it's kind of the same thing. I meant to mention it when I was talking about grinding, but it's one of these things. Coolant and grinding is the same way, where there are a lot of things that you may be doing because you've never even thought about it or analyzed it, and you may be leaving money on the table in terms of productivity or reducing scrap and things like that. There may be opportunities there that just because you've used a certain coolant it's always been done that way, or you've always ground something a certain way, you've always used a certain grinding wheel, and you've accepted some of these problems that you've had as just part of the business that you're in, it might be worth taking a second look at some of this stuff and educating yourself on things as mundane as coolant, because there are a lot of times some real opportunities there for improvement in some of these really mundane sounding things. All right, so we're going to talk a little bit about mixing coolant, understanding percent concentration and ratios. So first off, be able to do these two things. If you have a mix ratio, that is like an 8-to-1 mix, know what the percent concentration is. I think, it's just easier in my experience to deal with a percent concentration. Like you tell me it's 11.1% concentration, that makes good sense to me. And I can do my calculations a little bit easier. 8-to-1 is pretty easy to describe. You know, you've got like maybe 8 parts coolant, 1 part water, 8 parts water, 1 part coolant, something like that. Then you can figure out what the percent is by this little formula right here. Okay, so if you have 8-to-1, then that is 1 over 8 plus 1, 1 over 9. So that's 1/9, and that's 11.1%. Okay, so actually, you know, this would give you 0.111. To convert that to percent, you just multiply by 100 to move the decimal place over. All right, but that should be pretty easy to do. Then if you know the concentration and you want to convert it to a ratio, this is your formula. So if something you know is 10%, then it would be 100 minus the 10 to 10. So that's 90 to 10, or reduced down 9 to 1. All right, so now this is what you would, this is kind of the reason that you need to be able to do that that stuff there, okay? And let's look at topping up a fluid coolant reservoir that is that's had some evaporation take place, okay? So we want to top it back up and correct the concentration of a partially evaporated tank. So first of all, you have to know the capacity of the tank that you're trying to fill up. Okay, so whether it's, you know, 5 or 10 or 100 gallons, you need to know that, all right? One thing that, you know, so what that means is you need to know two things. Number one is you need to know how to find the volume of various three-dimensional shapes. So like a rectangular prism or, you know, a rectangle, a box shape is an example. And that's just length times the width times the height. The other sort of main tank shape would be a cylinder. So you need to be able to find the volume of a cylinder. And that's just the area of a circle, which is pi r squared, times the height, times the depth, however deep it is. Okay, so those will tell you the capacity in cubic inches by those formulas that you've heard since eighth grade or before. Calculate the volumes. Those will give you volumes in cubic inches. And then the second thing you need to know is that there are 231 cubic inches in a gallon. So if you know the number of cubic inches in a tank, then divide by 231, that will tell you the number of gallons in that tank. Okay, so let me go through an example here. All right, let's just say that we have this, we want to wind up with a tank that has a 7% concentration, and we've calculated that the tank has 100 gallons in it. Okay, so we know that we have a 100-gallon tank, and we know that we need a 7% concentration. Again, that may have been given as a ratio, and if that's the case, then you could have calculated the percent concentration from that formula that we just went over. Okay, so this is where we want to be. So we go out to the shop floor, and we find our tank is only this full. Okay. And we calculate the volume of fluid that's in the tank. So in this case, it would be the area of this circle down here multiplied by whatever the depth is, and that would tell us the number of gallons that we had. And then we go out and we use our refractometer and we measure the percent concentration of the coolant. And let's say in this case we measure 11%. So the way I like to do it is figure out, sort of hypothetically, how much concentrate. And what I like to do, even though these are mixed together, they're still the only two things in the tank. You've got water and you've got concentrate. And of course, they're stirred together, but you could picture in your mind as if the concentrate was separated from the water. And that's what I like to do to keep track of this. All right, so we've measured the concentration as 11%, and we know that there are 60 gallons of coolant in that tank. To find the amount of concentrate, the gallons of concentrate that are in the tank, we take the 11%. And of course, 11% means 11 divided by 100. That's what the per cent means. And that would give us 0.11. We multiply that by the current number of gallons in the tank. And that tells us that there are 6.6 gallons of concentrate currently in that tank. Now we want 100 gallons with 100 gallons overall of mixed with 7 gallons of concentrate. So immediately, if you know that you've got 6.6 gallons of concentrate in the tank, you know how much concentrate you'll need to add. Okay, and the amount of concentrate that you need to add is the 0.4 gallons. Okay, we have 7 gallons. We need 0.4 gallons of concentrate, and so we will add that. Now, what you're going to do is actually add it in another bucket. So this exercise is to step through the to get the numbers, and so you kind of do this in your mind. You say, okay, if I know I need 7 gallons, I have 6.6, I'm going to need to add 0.4 gallons of concentrate. All right, so we're going to pretend that we add that 0.4 gallons of concentrate to the tank, and now we don't have 60 gallons anymore. We have 60.4 gallons because we've added that little extra bit. Okay, and now you know how much water you would need to add because you take the 100 gallons that you need to start to finish with, subtract the 60.4 gallons where you currently are, and you get the 39.6 gallons of water that you need to add. Okay, so to make this up, you would take 39.6 gallons of water, you'd mix it with the 0.4 gallons of concentrate, then you would add it to the tank, and you would then mix that thoroughly. Okay, so you're going to need to be able to do this. So the things that you're going to be given may be the tank dimensions, and you'll have to calculate the capacity of the tank, or you may be given the dimensions of the, you know, the volume of the current state. You might need to take that, and you might find it in cubic inches. You would need to know to divide by 231 to get the number of gallons. Once that's done, you'll be given the ratio, because this is something you could go out and find on the shop floor with your refractometer. You can measure this. You would measure the 11%. Okay, and then you'd need to know how much coolant you would need to add and how much water you would need to add. Okay, so I put there is an example here. This is the example that I just kind of went through, but it's all on one slide there. Okay, so you'll need to know, be able to know how to do that. That's going to be on the quiz, and that's going to be on the test. All right, so that's all for cutting fluids, and we'll see you next time.